The Baltimore Station is a lifeline to homeless veterans year in and year out to get them back on their feet with new skills so they can become self-sustaining again. It is also a place that these veterans could heal together and get the skills they need to start a new life. I wanted to check in with Kim Callari, the Director of Development and Communications, on how much more difficult this job has become during the pandemic and how you can get involved. Good morning, Kim. Welcome back to Maryland Perspectives.
Good morning. Thank you for having me back.
Over the last couple of years that we have talked about what your nonprofit does, it seems to me that getting a homeless veteran off the street and accepting help is hard enough as it is. What challenges are you facing with providing residential services, and are you still accepting new residents during the COVID-19 crisis?
Yes, this whole pandemic has been extremely frustrating for the organization, and we've adjusted and put protocols in place, obviously, to keep our men safe and healthy and still engaged in their treatment. We had to abstain from taking any additional referrals on the week of March 9th. So unfortunately, we have not been able to take any new men into either our clinical program or our workforce development program. So that obviously, you know, that's been a big hit on the revenue side, but then also the fact that we can't bring anyone else new into the program and we can't help them right now. The good news is that we are looking, hopefully, over the next couple of weeks, can start taking new admissions into the program, because we are seeing, especially through our website, you know, people are now starting to reach out again and asking for help.
That's great. Because you're not accepting new people, does that mean that your residential houses are closed?
So what we've done is, so our residential program, we have about 50 men right now. And what we did when the virus first kind of started here in Baltimore, we actually found as much housing as we could for our men. And then a couple weeks into the virus, we actually decided that the best for their health and safety was to lock down the facility. Mm-hmm. So anyone at that time that was in the facility was actually staying in there. And we also had 3 clinical staff who were locked in and stayed with the men for 2 weeks. So we limited their everything. I mean, they're to and from. We have, you know, a kitchen staff who actually had a separate entrance, who still does actually separate bathrooms. There was no interaction with the residents. We ended up doing a couple of different meal services. Instead of having everyone come to breakfast together, we now have 2 breakfast, 2 lunch, 2 dinner services. We spread people out in the dorms. So we really tried with the 50 people that we had remaining at that point to really practice social distancing and to try and mitigate it the best that we could. And luckily, I mean, we were able to do that. I mean, the men, you know, they adapted really well. We started, our case managers, you know, we're all working remotely and doing, you know, telehealth. We had our drumming therapist is doing drumming remotely. So again, trying to keep as much routine for the men when everything else is kind of going crazy.
I know that's what I'm doing. I'm sure that's what you're doing at home as you're working as well. So it sounds like you were lucky enough to not have one case of COVID-19 because of the social distancing and because of the lockdown.
So we did end up with a couple of cases.
You did, okay.
So, yes, we did. We ended up with, so all during this whole time, we were trying to get tests. And there weren't enough tests, because what we wanted to do is test all of the men at South Baltimore in the clinical program to see what we're working with. Finally, I'm going to look up the date here, we were finally able to get testing, oh my gosh, it was like mid-April, through the assistance, through the help of the Mayor's Office of Homeless Services, the Health Department, and Healthcare for the Homeless. We were able to test everybody at South Baltimore.
Okay.
And who had been locked in. And ironically, half of the men tested positive.
Wow.
And half were negative, but none of them were showing, they were all asymptomatic.
That's insane.
So, right? So at that point, then, is when we actually took everyone, again, with the assistance of the Health Department and the Mayor's Office of Homeless Services, we took everyone off site and self-isolated them for 2 weeks. And then while they were in self-isolation for 2 weeks, we had our first symptomatic client on April 13th. And then we had three more clients become symptomatic. And the wonderful news is that they all received health care and we're all fully recovered.
That's fantastic. And we're hearing some of these stories across the board all over the country, and especially when it comes to the homeless populations, when you think about Los Angeles, where the homeless population is massive compared to what we have going on in Baltimore, which is still, if you look at, you know, how many people live in Baltimore City and County, it's a pretty big population per capita. And to be able to make sure that they're not just walking around with the virus is amazing. Are you in touch with other homeless agencies in the city? Are they doing the same thing for everybody?
So each agency is kind of not on their own, not by any chance, but kind of they're doing what they think is going to work best for that particular agency. But we are on weekly calls with, you know, the health department, with the mayor's office of homeless services. So there's a lot of collaboration and information sharing weekly, if not sometimes, you know, twice a week between all of the providers. So we all know kind of what the limitations are and who's being able to do what as we move through the pandemic.
So when do you think you're going to be able to start going out and maybe not get back to normal, quote unquote, but get back out and bring in new homeless veterans that you may be finding in the community?
So we're hoping to be able to do that within the next couple of weeks.
Okay.
What we will do is they will come into the facility and we will probably self-quarantine them for 2 weeks before they're introduced to the general population. Like I said, we're starting to get a lot of phone calls and emails through the website on people who are looking for help.
Exactly.
And obviously that's what we're here to do. And that's what we want to do. So our hope is that within the next couple of weeks, so let's say maybe by June 1st, we will be able to take referrals once again. So that's referrals into our clinical program. We also launched last year our outpatient program. So that has also been affected by the pandemic because we are not able, because again, outpatient, we're taking people from the community. We have not been able to do that either. That particular program, I am not sure. I'm hoping it's about the same time frame as we're able to accept clinical referrals, that we will also be able to accept outpatient referrals.
Right. It's all coming down right now to testing. It really is. We have to know who has it in order for the rest of us to move around and figure out how to, you know, stay safe. Wow. So you guys are in such a tough position right now. How can we help you? Do you know, we're seeing shortages of face masks and disinfectants. And I know that normally when I'm talking to you, we talk about donations to the house, say sheets for the beds, soap and different things like that, laundry items. What do you need right now?
We took, like most organizations, we took a huge hit revenue-wise. You know, we had to cancel our largest fundraiser, Home Run for Recovery, which generates over $170,000, which is a huge number for us. We haven't been able to accept any referrals, both into the clinical program and the outpatient program. And our expenses have also gone up because we suspended volunteer activities on March 9th. And volunteers are actually responsible for 50% of our food every year. So our costs just for food alone are up between $10,000 and $12,000 a month. We also went to disposable servingware for both facilities. So again, that's another couple thousand.
Mm-hmm.
The men are in the facility, so water bills are higher. So everything is higher and obviously not planned for in our budget. So what we can use the most right now, a couple of things, is obviously financial support and really $5, $10, whatever folks can afford, and any of the money that people donate goes directly to the men and to the programs and services that we're offering. We also have a wish list on our website, which is baltimorestation.org. And that wish list is updated daily, and it has on it, like you had said, sheets, towels, but the men are also inside most of the time. So we need weights, we need coloring books, because again, we're trying to keep them motivated and engaged in their therapy and in their treatment while they're kind of experiencing this pandemic. The wish list is a great way to support us. We're connected through Amazon Smile, so it's super easy, you know, for somebody to just go on, click buy what we need. It comes directly to our facility, and it's super, super easy and just a great way to support us.
Kim Callari is the Director of Development and Communications at the Baltimore Station. I'll make sure I get those links up on our website. And I tell you, Kim, the work you're doing right now under these circumstances is truly, truly remarkable. And thank you for always being there for veterans and giving them back the life that they were willing to give in the first place.
Thank you. Yeah, I really have to say, I mean, our men have been amazing throughout this whole process. We know that not having volunteers and everything in the facility is tough because they provide socialization for our men and engagement. But they've stood by us. And have really risen to the occasion, and we're all just blessed to be able to help them, and we look forward to the day when we can open the door and our volunteers can come back, and most importantly, when we can start accepting homeless veterans back into the program.